Welcome to beautiful Memphis, Tennessee, as we get set to watch the 2006 Choice Hotels U.S. Open Racquetball Championships. Hi, everyone. I'm Sean Royster, alongside former Top 5 pro Aaron Katz. Aaron, here we are in Memphis again. The U.S. Open, they bring in the portable court. Fans screaming and yelling throughout this entire event. You know this tournament means a ton to these players.
Hey, it's the biggest tournament of the year. It's exciting just to be here. You can feel the buzz in the club. It is the biggest, the best, and the road to number one goes through Memphis, Tennessee every year.
So as we mentioned, the best players in the world come here for this event. Let's talk about today's matchup. Alvaro Beltran, number three in the world. He was going to play the champion, Sudsy Manchek, but with Sudsy not showing up, was Alvaro tested?
Hey, Alvaro's not been tested. Very big tournament for Alvaro. He's never made it to the finals of a U.S. Open. He has won on the Pro Tour, a very much anticipated match against Sudsy, who's coming back, four-time U.S. Open champ, five-time season-end number one player. Sudsy had a forfeit his round of 16 against Alvaro due to a herniated disc, so Alvaro had a very easy time getting to the quarterfinals.
Alvaro's opponent today, Shane Vanerson, currently ranked number six in the world. We used to call him an up-and-comer, but with the success that he has had throughout these last two seasons, Shane Vanerson, quite the opposite of what Alvaro had to deal with. He had his hands full getting to this match today.
He had a very tough draw, and Shane, not an up-and-comer anymore, has had some success, as you point out, but Shane has an awful lot to prove. He came up a very heralded young player several years ago, and I do not think has accomplished what the racquetball world expected of him yet. There's no better place to establish himself than at the U.S. Open. Has really had a very impressive tournament to date. Round of 32s, beat former number two player in the world, John Ellis, and former U.S. Open finalist, and then a great up-and-coming player, former junior champ, Ben Croft, in the round of 16 to get to the quarterfinals. So he will be very prepared to play Alvaro today.
So an exciting quarterfinal match when we get back here. The number six player in the world, Shane Vanerson, versus the number three, Alvaro Beltran. When we get back, the 2006 Choice Hotels U.S. Open Racquetball Championships. The Choice Hotels U.S. Open Racquetball Championships is brought to you by Choice Hotels International, family of hotel brands with over 5,000 locations and 8 different brands worldwide, offering every type of accommodation in every price range. We meet all your travel needs. For reservations, visit us at choicehotels.com today. Choice Hotels, we'll see you there. And by Wilson Art Flooring. If it's tough enough for pro racquetball, it's tough enough for your home. Enjoy the beauty and durability of Wilson Art Flooring, available at fine floor covering centers everywhere. Also, Nuveen Investments, dedicated to helping you reach your goals in life. Ask your financial advisor today how Nuveen's growing range of equity and fixed income products can help you support your long-term plans. And by USA Racquetball, your link to the greatest game on earth. To learn more about how racquetball can improve your quality of life, visit usaracquetball.com for all the details.
It was almost 50 years ago when Danny Thomas had a dream. A dream of creating a unique research hospital devoted to curing catastrophic diseases in children. More than just a treatment facility, this would be a research center for children from all parts of the world. St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital has always played a big part in the sport of racquetball. Every year since the U.S. Open began here in Memphis, the players take time out to go over and visit these children. The Choice Hotels U.S. Open Racquetball Championships has donated now over $100,000 to St. Jude's. This helps in advancing the research and treatment for these brave children. Not only is this great for the kids to meet these professional athletes, but it's also a reminder to the players and all of us, truly, what real strength and courage is all about.
I feel pretty good. I've been training well this couple of months, so I'm ready. I'm ready to play. I just got to go and play hard. Like I said, I've been working on my serves and getting to the ball. So I feel I think I'm moving well, and that's what I need to do: move well in the court and serve well. My biggest strengths are my serve. I feel my serve and my confidence. I've been training hard this last 2 weeks for this tournament, and my confidence level is pretty good, and I think I'm serving well, so I shouldn't have any excuses after the match. I'm a little shocked about not playing Satsi yesterday, but I feel fresh and ready to play today.
The US Open, I feel more relaxed. Kind of like I've been here before, done it. It's kind of the same old ball game. Basically figured out in my 4 years here on tour that it just comes down to who's going to execute in the matches. And, you know, you can have a game plan going in, but once the ball first serves hit, it's kind of all out the window. Yeah, I play Alvaro Beltran. He's got an all-around game. He's probably going to lob serve me. He's probably going to drive serve me a little. He's going to make some good gets. He's going to kill the ball. And I just gotta outshoot him, outthink him, and get some more balls than him. My pinch shot, my splash shot has to be on both sides to keep the pressure on. And then when he moves forward, that's when I gotta hit my pass shots and just not skip the ball. Alvaro has a tendency to skip some balls sometimes, so I'm gonna try and put some pressure on him. Sometimes he can go through 4, 5, 6 skips in a row, and when he does that, those make the games a lot easier.
Here we are, Aaron Katz. Shane Vanderson, the number 6 player in the world. Alvaro Beltran, the number 3 player in the world from Mexico, wearing the blue. Shane in the red. Should be an exciting match. Quarterfinals, 2006, Choice Hotels, U.S. Open. Aaron, can you make a prediction about this match?
This is a tough call. Alvaro's clearly the favorite, the higher seed. Shane's an up-and-coming player. And very, very prepared to take the next step. I think it's going to be a very tight match, but since I know you're going to press me on it, I'm going to pick Shane to have the upset victory here.
Well, Shane's been playing great, Paul. You can't deny that prediction just because of the fact that, you know, Shane has literally the toughest backhand in the business. And he's just been playing phenomenal ball. He's proven that he can win big and big matches.
He's been to the semis here. He lost to Derek Robinson in the semis 3 years ago. I love his game. Not only does he have a great backhand, he's got such quick hands, very quick feet, very smooth. The thing Shane's going to have to control that I've seen him struggle with in the past is his shot selection. He has a tendency to start forcing shots. So if he can play with a little more poise, a little more discipline, I think he's going to be very tough for Alvaro to handle.
Here comes Alvaro with a drive serve right off the bat.
Point.
That's a great shot. I think we're going to see, if you notice, if you're watching racquetball at home for the first time, you haven't seen these two players before. Shane Vanderson in the back wearing red.
Short, set up. Zero serving one.
That was awfully close. Tough to see on that right wall there. I think it was short. I think it was short. What do you think, Sean?
Tough to see as well, but I think it might have been short as well. Could have been a good call. What I was about to say there is most of the time when you play racquetball, you try to stay away from the forehand of the most players just because that's their strongest point. However, in this match, a little unique situation where Shane has got a much more powerful backhand. What do you think about that observation?
I think it's accurate. I think maybe both of these players have a better backhand, particularly up in the front court. Both of them are devastating up in the front court with their re-kills on their backhand side. Great shot there by Shane.
171.
That's just a thunderous serve by Shane Vanderson. Another weapon.
You know, Shane's got all the tools. If he ever brings it all together, he's going to be tough for anybody to handle. He hits hard. He's fast. He's got good hands. He's got good, smooth way about him. You know, so Shane is a very, very talented player. You know, that being said, he has had the physical tools for a long, long time and has not yet brought it all together to win that big tournament. I don't think he's won a pro stop on the IRC Tour yet. That's a nice shot. He made that look a lot easier than it was. The ball came up at an awkward height to his backhand. He straightened up and hit a very tough pinch in the corner.
Goes to the backhand.
Hold it. Replay.
Wow.
One serving three.
Alvaro Beltran, definitely known as one of the best players to come out of Mexico, has won many pro stops, but never has won a U.S. Open title.
Two,
yeah.
Serving three.
He's been to the semis, I remember, and that's the furthest I remember him advancing at the U.S. Open. Great get by Shane.
Hold it, skip ball.
And as we discussed earlier,
three serving two.
Shane Vanderson came off a couple of pretty hardcore matches where he had to play the former number two player in the world, John Ellis, and then played Ben Croft, who's an up-and-comer, who was a national and world junior champion, a national collegiate champion. So Shane definitely had his hands full with the matches leading up to this. However, Alvaro, on the other hand, had a match against the great Sudsy Manchik, and Sudsy backed out, no pun intended, to his back injury.
Yeah, that was a huge disappointment for the crowd. They were really anticipating that match. It was clearly the highest profile round of 16 match. They played at the last tournament. I think they went five games. So that was a big disappointment to Sudsy, I'm sure, as well as the crowd. And here you see a great example of Shane's hands. Alvaro left up his backhand pin. Shane was a little off balance, but still was able to stretch over and hit a delicate little rekill.
So you hear a lot of terminology if you're just watching racquetball for the first time. We're going to do our best to try to help you out with following this game. It's a very, very fast game, been said by many to be the fastest sport in the world, with the ball going near 200 miles an hour. A pin shot, as you referred to earlier, is when the ball hits the sidewall, then the front wall first, which would be one of the corners. A kill shot, hitting it as low as you possibly can, which is the best. Whoop. Great gets. Oh, wow. Both players diving all over the court. What a great rally. Back to my point here. Kill shot, hitting the ball as low as you possibly can on the front wall to keep your opponent from getting the ball on one bounce. Drive serve from Alvaro Beltran.
Skip, point. Five, serving four.
You know, pretty good start for both players. Not a lot of errors so far. Mostly winners. Both of the players look relaxed. Both of them look into the game. And this is a big match for both these players. Real opportunity for them to take their career to the next level.
Broken ball. We're going to replay that rally.
Yeah, and you know, you say Alvaro's won some pro stops, and he has, but I don't think he's ever finished a year in the top two. They're on the opposite side. This is the opposite side of the draw from Jack Huzak and Jason Menino. You know, clearly two guys that have a lot of pedigree. So this is a big opportunity for the winner of this match to get to the semis and be looking at a real opportunity to play in the finals of the U.S. Open.
Set up.
Yeah, Shane had a setup there and ripped that backhand off the back wall, gave Alvaro a setup, and Alvaro, very relaxed, very calm, just killed the ball down the right wall. That's off the back wall.
Wow, Alvaro catches that sidewall crack. It's 6-4. We're going to take a little break here. Alvaro with the lead, 6-4 in game one. Welcome back. Alvaro with a lob serves to the forehand of Shane Vanderson.
Skip ball, skip.
Wow.
Seven serving four.
Good shots from Alvaro.
Yeah, Shane, he's looked a little bit loose these last couple of rallies. He's gone for some awkward looking overheads. Really needs to tighten up his shot selection a little bit and get a little more focused. There's a setup off the back wall for Alvaro. Great get by Shane. Unbelievable guess.
Oh. Oh, my God. Wow. That was just amazing.
Unbelievable.
The way those players just change direction like cat-like quickness and just diving all over the court. That was incredible.
Yeah, that's classic pro racquetball there. Guys getting to the irretrievable and doing something with it. Each of them made a great get, but did something with the ball to put pressure on their opponent. Finally, Alvaro couldn't recover from his dive.
Set up.
Great shot by Alvaro, but
seven,
that ball was up. I think that ball, Shane must have stopped or been backing up to not cover that, because I thought that was actually easier to get to than some of the balls he didn't get that he got to on the rally before.
Alvaro sticking with that serve.
Wow.
Set up. 4-7-7.
Unbelievable shot there by Shane. Again, he looks very, very casual, probably too casual for my personal liking, but you can't argue with the results on that. Just a flat overhead rollout.
Side out.
There's a nice,
seven,
much higher percentage shot. Beltran, rather than trying to roll it out with his forehand up high, he just drilled it down the line, had Shane leaning a little bit, and that's a much higher percentage play than the shot that Shane hit to side Alvaro out.
Point.
Nice Boy, hands.
Great shot. And that is really Alvaro's bread and butter, too. He is known for having some of the quickest hands in the game, and that was a perfect example. That ball was moving very quickly, and he was able to hit a pin shot in that right
screen
corner.
Now, that is known as a screen serve, which is the ball's too close to the body of the server, resulting in a replay of the serve.
Boy, Alvaro looks really
nine,
crisp.
Seven, four.
Stepping over, ripping every ball, putting a lot of pressure on Shane. Alvaro's done a nice job controlling this first game. This is the most confident I've seen Alvaro play with in the last few years that I've seen him play. Looks really sharp, really relaxed.
That's why you avoid Shane Vanderson's backhand.
Yeah.
That's unbelievable. That is just such a low percentage shot. Most players.
And again, we talked a lot about this in last week's match when we saw a great victory by Jason Menino. You know, there's almost an advantage to Alvaro for Shane to have to hit that shot, because if he's got to hit that greater shot just to side a guy out, that wears on you mentally after a while. There we saw an avoidable hinder where Beltran hit the ball back through the middle, gave Shane a setup. And
six,
the referee gave, I think appropriately, Shane the point on an avoidable hinder. A couple of quick points here for Shane, though, from 4-9 to 6-9, getting back in this game. We talk about this every year when we do this, Sean. It's real important when you fall way down like 9-4 that you work your way back into the game, even if you don't come all the way back, just to change the momentum.
Seven, 9.
Unbelievable shot there.
I mean, in what, a matter of a minute? He's just put himself right back into this first game. Looked like Alvaro was just running with it.
Yeah.
And then Shane with just a couple of great shots and some phenomenal serves. Watch this serve. This is... Oh!
Right up.
Alvaro Beltran diving and re-killing the ball.
That is unbelievable.
Nine,
I mean, he made it look kind of easy, but that was a phenomenal shot. He was in midair, took a full swing, and hit that pinch in the right corner with power. Usually when you see guys dive, even if they re-kill the ball, they're just touching or tapping the ball. That was a full swing.
Great athleticism. Both of these players really playing at a very high level right now.
There has not been a lot of free points. Both players are having to hit phenomenal shots to score a point.
A lob serve from Shane Vanderson. That's a good one. Look at that. Stays focused and rips the ball down the right side.
Yeah, again, very, very high quality play so far. Both players very focused, very intense.
Side out. 7-9.
Another great shot by Shane. Again, this is, you know, pro racquetball at its best. Every time one player even makes a subtle mistake, the other player punishes them with a rollout.
Skip ball, skip. Skip right off the racket, Bobby.
Yeah, I don't know if it was two bounces or a skip, but I could tell that wasn't good.
Yeah, I think it was the right call.
Shane Vanderson right back in it, 8-9 in game one.
Skip ball.
Skipped it.
Ball skipped in the front.
7-8.
It's a huge miss. I mean, you talk about a game of inches. Shane made a great get, went for the right shot, tried to hit a soft little pinch in that left corner, and just skipped it by a hair. So instead of completing his comeback from 9-4 to 9-9, now Alvaro serving again at 9-8, which is always a big relief after you've just called a timeout to slow up your opponent.
White.
Boy, that momentum in this game at this level changes so quickly. You know, we were talking about it could have been 9-9. Now it's 10-8. Alvaro, you know, serving to end the game.
Wow, and Shane Vanderson does it let it happen.
Serving 10.
He clawed his way back. Do you remember the deficit? He was down
9-4.
He was down 9-4.
Came back to 8-9. Alvaro called a very smart, savvy timeout, came back, sided Shane out on that missed pinch, got to 10. That's a great get.
Ball's down, Shane.
Boy, opportunity there for Shane. And to Alvaro's credit, Shane hit an unbelievable serve. He did all he could to get it to the ceiling. Shane had a forehand setup off the back wall. To your point earlier, Sean, his forehand's a little bit weaker. Left it up on the forehand pinch, and Alvaro re-killed his backhand beautifully.
Oh.
First game, Alvaro.
That was a dramatic way to finish game one as Alvaro dives and re-kills it in the right side wall.
It's unbelievable.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Well, only fitting that we're in Memphis, a place known for its music, that we've got the music blaring, we got singers everywhere. Exciting event here at the U.S. Open, and what a great match so far, 11-8. Alvaro Beltran takes game one.
Great game. Very, very high standard of play. Alvaro ended it with a phenomenal forehand re-kill. Several great shots towards the end of that game. Be very interesting to see if Shane can up his level just enough to pull his way back into this match.
We're going
to
find out. We're coming back for game two in just a moment.
Welcome back. Alvaro Beltran takes game one. And a skip coming from Shane Vanderson's backhand. Aaron, catch. You just don't see it very often.
You know. And good serve by Alvaro. You know, he's been mixing up his serves very well. He's hit some very good drives, couple aces, hit a couple of high arcing lobs. There he hit kind of a half lob. Mixing it up real well, I think, which is his strategy against Shane. Because if you let Shane get grooved in, he can be devastating.
Alvaro with a lob serve to the forehand. He's been serving that. That forehand. I love it when you talk about the game plan of players and when it's noticeable that somebody comes in without a game plan. Obviously here, Alvaro Beltran came in with a game plan to just attack the forehand of Shane Vanderson, and thus far it's been working.
Yeah, and that's been Shane's downfall in the years we've been here. He gets on the court, and there doesn't seem to be any pattern or any game plan to his shot selection. And I think that's, and we talked a lot about this earlier, Sean, that's, I think, the primary reason that's pulled him back from not breaking into that top five and being a contender in the big events.
Side out. 2-0.
You see Alvaro, very relaxed, very purposeful out there, you know, really hitting smart shots and controlling the tempo.
And as you could see there, Alvaro tried to sneak in a shot, sneaking a serve to the backhand of Shane. And, you know, he may not have got the greatest return. However, most of the time you serve to the backhand of Shane, Shane's going to win that rally.
That's three skips already for Shane this game. Both of Alvaro's points were scored on Shane's skips, and there's another skip to give Alvaro back the serve, and then you see mixing up the angle there with a high arcing serve set up off the back wall.
Point three,
fourth skip there for Shane. So he's down 3-0, one game to zero and 3-0. He's got to really turn it around. You don't want to go down two games to zero against Alvaro Beltran.
0-7-3.
Again, Shane sometimes he's just a little too casual. He won that point, but a very casual looking overhead. That's a great shot. Alvaro hit a pretty good, not a great, but a pretty good backhand pinch. Shane, full head dive, was able to hit a beautiful touch forehand pinch on the dive in the right corner.
That's a great serve.
Set up for Shane. Wow.
Alvaro almost got a racket on that.
Yeah. That was an absolute missile.
Two serving three now. Shane Vanderson trying to find his way into this match.
Skip ball.
Boy.
Three, serving
That's
two.
At least Shane's fifth skip this game. You know, he's down 3-2, so he's still right in the game, but how different could this game be if he hadn't skipped all those balls?
That's a great backhand by Shane Vanderson.
Two, serving three. Hold it. Hit the light, replay.
Going to replay that rally. The ball hit the light on the outside of the court. Another skip ball for Shane Vanderson.
Now we may start just counting. We've got a statistician helping us out, Sean, but let's start counting you and I. That's six skips at least for Shane this game.
Wow, what a nice diving re-kill by Shane Vanderson. We're going to take a little break now as he cleans up the floor. Alvaro Beltran
two, serving three.
Leads the series 1-0. We'll be right back.
Shot selection is one of the most critical parts of the game. As you can see, when Jason is behind his opponent, as you would be if you were behind your opponent, the ball's in his hitting zone, he's going to hit a passing shot, or if it's out of his hitting zone, he's going to hit a ceiling ball, which draws me out of the middle. If you are in front of your opponent, as Jason is in front of me, that's the time when you pinch or you kill, which keeps the ball in front of the court and moves me forward.
Welcome back. Shane Vanderson up in the service box, two serving three, lob serve to the backhand. And bad miss by Alvaro Beltran, but it's a good shot by Vanderson. It's a good rally.
Yeah, good rally. He left that last one up. I think he got a little lucky. Alvaro thought he was a better shot. Headed into his dive, and then I think got jammed a little bit.
All tied up here, three serving three.
Skip ball.
Yeah, just missed.
I couldn't tell until it bounced.
Yeah, no, you couldn't tell on that one until the second bounce. It was so close, but then you were able to see the backspin on the second bounce, and you knew it skipped. And Alvaro, these are two of the more honest players on the tour. Alvaro didn't even try and walk up to the service box and take it. He knew it was a skip.
Five serving three.
You know, Shane is just, he's very fun to watch. It was a little bit frustrating to watch, but very fun. He's feast or famine. Here we are in the second game talking so much that he skipped six balls, but he's up 5-3. And there's another phenomenal shot. Just feast or famine with him there. He hits a circus forehand re-kill with a ball behind his body, rolls it out in the right corner, and he's up 6-3 just like that. just a couple of minutes ago, we were talking about he's down 3-0 and in trouble of kind of really falling out of this match.
The circus forehand rekill. I love it. And Vanderson's got such great hands and great hand speed that he's got the ability to really, I mean, if the ball is just fired at him, he's got the ability to rekill the ball rather than just tap it.
It's unbelievable
up
to watch.
The wall. It's incredible.
He's really uniquely talented.
That's a great shot.
Unbelievable. Just hits the ball so flat. That ball just rolled out.
Now, if you ever hear us use the terminology a splat, that's exactly what that is. How do you define a splat versus what a pinch would be, which is tight in the corner?
3-6.
Splat is
when the ball hits the sidewall deeper. And what it does is by hitting the sidewall deeper, it picks up a greater level of spin, so it dies more on the front wall than the typical pinch that hits the sidewall closer to the front wall. And at the pro level, you'll see an awful lot of splats where they're hitting the ball deep into the sidewall.
Shot. 3-6.
And it is a really fun match to watch because it's just a lot of ripping, a lot of running, a lot of rollouts. Much, much different from watching a Jason Menino who's so tactical. Leaves a lot of balls up, but gets to so many balls, you know, it really wears on you mentally. This is just much more running and gunning, kind of like watching one of the movies from the Wild Wild West with a lot of gunslingers just going around. A lot of fun to watch these young players just ripping and running all over the court.
Another point for Shane Vanderson, 7-4.
Yeah, and now Alvaro's starting to skip some, leave some up. That one he skipped again just by a hair.
I like that serve too. He realized that it works. No. He went with it. Let's see what I'm curious what he's going to serve when we get back from this break here. 8-4, game two.
Four.
Welcome back. Shane Vanderson with a lob serve. Great get by Alvaro Beltran. Another great get by Alvaro Beltran. Wow. What a great rally for Alvaro Beltran as he threw his body all over the court on the defense the entire rally and then somehow pulls out the victory on that rally. I don't know how he pulled it off.
Yeah, that was like watching a Jason Menino rally where he was just relentless, getting to every ball. Shane had set up after set up, finally left one up just a little bit. Alvaro hit a good shot. Shane covered it, but unfortunately skipped it on his rekill attempt.
Point.
Kind of a lackadaisical forehand. No bending of the knees.
Yeah, and again, he's got that tendency to just hit some loose shots. That's about a seventh skip this game, but he's still up 8-5. So,
ooh. That's that forehand. You wouldn't see him do that if that was a backhand.
You know, he's kind of exacerbating to watch, but at this level, to be giving up two free points like that at this point in the game is not acceptable.
This will be the best out of five.
8-6.
211 points. Got to win by two. One serve. There's no fault serve, as you've noticed in this match.
What?
It's
9-6.
Very good time out there by Shane. He had hit two very bad shots to get Alvaro from 4-8 to 6-8. Sided Alvaro out and scored a point, 9-6. Good experience play by Shane. And that's an example of how he's matured over the last couple of years.
Skip ball. Serving nine.
Bad skip there.
Hold on, replay. That ball is still up, Al.
Ooh. I don't know about that call. I think that ball was down. Yeah, but Alvaro did hit it through the center of the court, so maybe he took the risk that they'd call the...
Right.
That's a great shot.
9-6.
It looks almost like a shot you'd hit in a horse. Doesn't even look like he's in the quarterfinals of the U.S. Open. You know, I'm going to step up, roll it, overhand, left corner, looking the other way.
To use your term, very loose, just standing straight up and just took a very easy last digital shot, but it worked out.
Great cover there by Alvaro. Shane left his backhand pinch up, and Alvaro just hit a beautiful down-the-line pass. Off the back wall for Alvaro.
Skip point.
Skip by Shane.
That's 7-9.
That's at least number 8 for skips to bring Alvaro to 7-9. And let's see if Shane can really pull it together here. Alvaro's clearly favoring that forehand.
Skip, set up.
Good shot there by Shane. Hit a good overhand pass. And Alvaro, again, you mentioned it earlier, Sean, really sticking with his game plan, playing the Vanderson forehand.
Skip, point.
Boy, another skip by Alvaro. And the quality of play in this game, we talked about how the quality was in the first game, a clear drop-off in this game.
Noticeable drop on. Look at that. That's a brutal skip to finish game two. Both players have one game apiece. We'll be right back here for game 3 in Memphis, Tennessee.
In order to start the rally, you need to serve. To serve, you have to stand between these two solid red lines, hit the ball against the front wall. The ball needs to travel past the second red line on a fly without touching the back wall on a fly. And here's what it looks like. And now your rally started. Now that you've served the ball, your opponent needs to hit it before it bounces twice. Once he does hit it, it needs to hit the front wall before it hits the floor. If it hits the floor first, it's called a skip, and you've won the rally.
Well, Aaron, game 2 in the can, kind of the trash can, as you mentioned, really, the first game was such a high level of racquetball, and then that second game, 10 or 12 skips apiece, both players didn't really play that well in game 2.
Yeah, and part of what makes watching these two so exciting is they hit so many great shots, they run, and they hit, go for spectacular shots. Unfortunately, that sometimes results in the level of play dropping a little bit, like we saw in game 2. Let's see if they can regroup and bring up the standards here in game 3.
We're both players on the court for game 3. Shane Vanderson with a lob serve. Skip ball.
Boy, just, you know, again, starting off with a kind of a sloppy rally. Beltran covered that ball easily and then just skipped it in the corner.
Big ceiling ball here. Shane Vanderson's backhand.
Side out.
Uncharacteristic miss, as Shane Vanderson has one of the best backhands in the game.
Skip, side out. One serving zero.
Alvaro going for a nice little touch shot in the corner, but just missed.
Yeah, Shane hits the ball so hard that even a shot like that that looked pretty easy, the ball had so much pace on it
that
I think it's kind of tough to get your racket around. Great shot there by Alvaro.
You know, we constantly talk about the hand speed of Shane Vanderson, but we got to give a little props to Alvaro Beltran. He's got some great hands up front.
You know, similar styles here. They both run and gun a lot. I think Alvaro's a little bit more of an evolved player, a little more thoughtful on the court. Shane's probably got a little more power, but very, very similar styles. Both of them play with a reckless abandon, go for a lot of great shots, hit the ball hard, very quick hands. So it'll be interesting to see who's able to pull it together for the longest period of time to win this match.
Wow. Oh, no. Oh, man, that's not good, as you can tell by the crowd. Not a great call at all. But, hey, listen, what are you going to do? We've talked many times about officiating this game. Jason's one set of eyes, he didn't catch it.
It's a very tough game to ref. And, again, I'd love to get it. We can get Dave Negrete, the IRT Tour commissioner, to explain to us what the thought process is to not reinstate the appeals. I'd be curious in his response.
171.
I don't see any reasonable explanation for not reinstating the appeal process. Sean, I'm going to throw that over to you and let you run with it.
Well, we've talked about this for years and years. We talked about it last week in detail, and the fact is this is one of, if not the fastest sport in the world. The ball goes near 200 miles an hour. It's tough to see everything, and you've got one set of eyes back there.
Good shot.
Great backhand by Shane Van Andersen. That's just incredible. But, you know, but the fact is having two guys sit back here and help with the officiating like any other sport out there, it just makes sense.
I did not like Dave's answer last year when I asked him why they don't have the appeal process.
What was that answer?
His answer was that, Aaron, I'd be afraid you wouldn't have anything to talk about if we reinstated the appeal process, since you take up about a third of your commentary each year talking about it.
Yeah, that is true. You do rip that. Rip that into him. Oh, Vanderson with an around the back retrieval off the back wall.
He's just so casual. It looks so relaxed. It looks like he's playing a league match at the club. You wouldn't realize that as relaxed as he is, that he's playing in the quarterfinals of the biggest tournament of the year.
Replay. 3-7-1.
There you see Alvaro looking up, trying to get the avoidable. That's a tough call. I mean, Shane hit a terrible serve. Really it did wrap around off the back wall. He did not clear enough. Tough call. What do you think, Sean?
Well, anytime you take away an offensive opportunity and the player doesn't jump or make any attempt to get out of the way.
So you would give him the avoidable.
I think it might have been avoidable.
Hold 2. 1-7-3.
Again, it's very tough. You know, unlike the match last week where there was a clear rhythm and you really got a sense with Cliff and Jason who had the momentum going, it's very, very difficult to feel a rhythm in this match and get a sense who's in control because they both hit great shots, then they make some bad errors, and you really don't have any sense of momentum. At some point, somebody's going to have to pull it together and sustain it for a little bit longer period of time.
1-3.
Here's Alvaro with a drive serve.
White.
Vanderson had his setup off the back wall and missed a backhand, giving Alvaro a setup and he made him pay for it.
Right out.
It's a great shot.
Yeah.
3-7-2.
Again, it's kind of a strange match. It's 3-2, Shane over Alvaro, and you just don't have any sense that somebody's going to pull away or fall apart. You know, a lot of...
Hold it. Set out 2-7-3.
You know, I thought he said...
Hold it as in the hinder.
Yeah, and then he kind of changed his call when he realized Shane wasn't going to ask for it.
We're going to take a little break here. Alvaro Beltran serving to Shane Vanderson. We'll be right back.
In the game of racquetball, the only way you can score a point is if you're serving. If your opponent wins the rally when you're serving, it's called the side out, and it's their turn to serve and your turn to receive. The dotted line is on the court to protect the server. The receiver is not allowed to enter into this safety zone until the ball has bounced. But once the ball bounces, this line disappears.
Hello, I'm Sean Royster, and today I'm standing on the grounds of Graceland. Elvis bought this home in 1957 for just over $100,000. And now, with over 600,000 visitors a year, it is the second most visited home in the U.S., and second only to the White House. Today we have exclusive access into Graceland. So now let's take a walk inside and see how the king really lived.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
Here I am standing in Elvis's living room. In the back you see the music room, and this is the front end. This is where Elvis would play host to family and friends. As some of you may know, Elvis was an avid racquetball player. He loved the game so much that he had a racquetball court built at Graceland. I'm standing here at center court. Behind me is the front wall. And what you see is gold records. It's all overflow from the Hall of Gold inside his house. He spent $200,000 to have this court constructed, which is double what he paid for the house itself. The black horse over my right shoulder is Ebony's double. Elvis bought this Tennessee Walking in 1975. And right here over my left shoulder is Priscilla Presley's horse that she still owns. Both horses alive and well and still roaming the grounds of Graceland.
Two serving three.
Alvaro with a decent serve.
Oh, what quick hands.
These guys' hands are so quick. I mean, it's fun to watch. I mean, he just ripped it back at Shane. Shane rips it back at him, and then he rolls it out down the right wall.
All tied up, three serving three.
Ball set up.
Boy, yeah. Alvaro there was rewarded for his game plan. Served it over to Shane's forehand like he has been. Shane gave him a setup off the back wall, and Alvaro just skipped it in the corner.
To your point, Aaron, at this point, if you had to make a call and put some money on this, on who's going to win, I mean, really, it's just coin toss at this point.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'd take Shane just because he seems to be hitting more spectacular shots, and at this point, they seem to be making an equal amount of errors. Good down the line by Shane.
Oh, nasty. Backhand.
5-7-3.
Yeah, he does hit some spectacular shots, but if you don't block him out, I can see where it would get a little discouraging because just those are irretrievable rollouts. There's another setup for Shane. Good get.
Point.
Wow, that was very close to being an injury.
Yeah, let's see.
As his feet got kind of
six serving three
tangled underneath him. The Cowboys gonna come out and wipe up the floor. Shane Vanderson with another lob serve and a skip ball.
Seven serving three
now. Shane Vanderson.
Wow. Great, sir.
Just the fact that it caught that side wall was just incredible.
Sean, that is an unbelievable, what's called a lob nick serve, where you hit a high arcing lob into the back corner, and it nicked the side wall. That one was hit to perfection. Very high-risk serve.
And that was a skip ball.
Boy, Alvaro has really fallen apart this game. Really, the last two games has not played well at all. Casual looking ceiling ball.
That's a good shot.
3-9.
Set up off the back wall.
You know, we saw last week two players that play with so much passion and emotion. These two players have such poise and keep their cool and generally don't argue and scream and yell at the ref and scream at themselves. Have you noticed that?
Yeah, I'd like to see them, Sean, using their emotions a little more positively. They seem like they hold their emotions so in that they don't play with quite the intensity I'd like to see. They both have phenomenal physical tools. Great hands, a lot of power, quick feet. I'd really like to see both of them bring their mental game to a new level. Really play with a little more intensity, a little more passion.
That was a great pass, but just shocking that Alvarez had the mindset to quickly move and actually get a racket on it. That was incredible.
Time's in. 9 serving 5.
Shane Vanderson up to a 9-5 lead. Around the back, almost makes that, just barely skipped.
Again, you know, Shane, he's got to close this game out, 9-5. There was a shot. It wasn't an easy shot, but he didn't have to go around the back with that. He could have either taken a backhand, flicked it to the ceiling, done something a little higher percentage than that.
Point.
Skip again.
6 serving 9.
And we saw this at the last game. Shane was up 8-4, skipped a couple of forehands to get it to 8-6. Let's see if Alvaro can work his way back in. There he goes, sticking with that forehand. Good overhead by Shane. Lucky break there by Alvaro. Very lucky break there. You know, Alvaro hit a
6-9.
Great shot. Really was hugging the wall, and then it really brought him back in the rally by going outside the court for a play over, and Alvaro was very much on the defense, so that was a good break for him.
Got it.
Unbelievable. Wow. Get. Unbelievable.
Look at the hands.
Wow.
There's some emotion.
Shane showing a little bit of passion. Well-deserved emotion, too. A phenomenal rally. He makes an incredible get off the back wall. And then Beltran hit an absolute missile at his backhand. We've been talking so much about how quick their hands are. Shane just re-kills that missile right down the line.
That was incredible. What athleticism, Shane Vanderson. Full-out dives to the backcourt. In the right position, hit a really good shot, but again, to your point, the hand speed of Shane Vanderson was just flawless, right? That was amazing.
Here he's going back to this Z serve that he's had a fair bit of success with. Boy, wow. Alvaro just steps over and rips that ball. That's a great shot. Shane hit that serve about right where he wanted to.
Hold it, 2.
Good shot there by Shane. Hit a beautiful, took a little bit of pace off it, which is tough for Shane because he likes blasting everything. Took a little bit of pace off it, hit a great pinch in the corner. Alvaro didn't stop at all, went for it. May have gotten a racket on it, but just couldn't get it to the front wall. And here you see Shane. He understands the importance of these serves now, up 9-6, really taking his time, thinking a lot about what serve to hit. Goes back to that lob, Nick. Comes off the back wall a little bit. Boy, what a get.
Good shot.
Unbelievable. The crowd loves it.
And I love the emotion that Shane has brought these last couple of points. There he makes a spectacular get off the back wall. Alvaro thought the ball was down and kind of stopped. Shane comes back into play very smartly, doesn't charge too far forward to force Alvaro to kill the ball. Alvaro hits an okay shot, but Shane, again, exhibiting those phenomenally quick hands, re-kills the forehand off the sidewall.
And now Shane Vanderson with a chance to win Game 3 and go up in the series 2-1, and he does. When we get back here, Game 4, Shane Vanderson has a lead, 2-1. You know we're in Memphis when the banjo comes out, Aaron Katz.
World banjo champ.
This is the world banjo champ playing here behind us. But we're here with the world's best racquetball player, Shane Vanderson, Alvaro Beltran. Started to get a little boring there in Game 2. Excitement in Game 1. Excitement in Game 3 as Shane Vanderson starts coming alive, showing some emotion, pumping his fist. What did you think of that game?
I thought it was a great game, and we were talking a lot of early on in that third game. You just don't get a sense for one player stepping up, being in control, and you were kind of looking for the first one to do it. Shane really stepped up at the end of that game, played with a lot of passion, hit some great shots, and he's got a 2-1 lead, one game away from a second U.S. Open semifinal.
So we're going to find out if Shane Vanderson will push through to the semifinals or if Alvaro Beltran will come back.
Yep. 1-0.
That is unreal. I mean, Shane hit a pretty good backhand splat off a tough lob serve. Alvaro dove, stretched out, and absolutely buried a shot in the left corner, what we call a cockroach killer.
Did you just pull?
I pulled out the cockroach killer. Do you understand the origin of that term? Take a shot at it.
The only thing I can think of, a cockroach crawling on the front wall. And you hit it that low, it smashes. As that is the height of a cockroach, hence the cockroach killer.
You got it.
Tell me.
Have you never heard that term before?
Tell me you invented that or something, because I'd like to think that that's not a term in our sport.
You know, I'll take credit for it. So you've been playing, involved in the sport how long, Sean?
15, 16 years.
And you've never heard the term cockroach killer?
Never, and I don't know that I want to hear it ever again.
Skip.
That was
one.
A skip ball from Shane Vanderson. Oh, another very, very loose, easy forehand.
We talked about it. It's like watching. He's like a horse. He's like watching the Michael Jordan and Charles Barkley play horse. They just hit one great shot after another. They look so casual about it.
2-1.
Alvaro hit me a lob to my forehand, and I'm going to call roll out in the left corner.
That was incredible, especially from that high.
There's another great lob, Nick. Shane really hits that serve well. Wow. That's a great shot by Alvaro. You see a very smart move there. He had Shane pinned over to the left side. And to prevent Shane from getting back in the rally, you saw Alvaro spin to hit a forehand. And then very wisely just hit a forehand down the line and had Shane blocked out so he couldn't cover the shot.
That's tough. The forehand of Shane Vanderson.
2-1.
Alvaro hit a great serve, and he caught the crack, and the ball kind of shot back a little bit. Shane, with great racket preparation and hand speed, just rolled a splat.
White.
Boy. Wow, Shane's playing great right now.
Yeah, no, we were talking a lot about you were waiting for somebody to get in a rhythm and take control of the match. Well, Shane Vanderson's gotten a little bit of rhythm, taking control of the match. He's hitting that lob, Nick, very deep to Alvaro's backhand. He looks very, very comfortable. Another lob, Nick, catching that sidewall. Boy, that's a great shot by Alvaro. You know, Shane hit that serve so well that I think Alvaro had no choice but hit that pitch. I would have liked to have seen Shane move up a little bit more, cover that, and reward himself for that good serve.
Oh, just fully extended.
Flick up.
That's just tough.
Boy, Shane is clearly in control of this match right now. Alvaro is on the defense. Really scrambling just to stay in these points. Shane, I would say he looks very relaxed, but he always looks very relaxed, so I don't know that that's indicative of the fact that he's taking control. Nevertheless, Shane Vanderson is in total control of this match, up 2-1 and 3-1 in the fourth game.
As we talked about different players with their game plan, it looked to me like Shane Vanderson came in with kind of a run and gun, coming in, bringing drives, for bringing the heat right off the bat, and he's completely switched that whole theory around, and now he's hitting these lob serve, and it's all working for him.
Yeah, it's a great observation, Sean.
What?
The lob serve has really worked him into the match. He looks like he's got much more of a pattern to what he's trying to do, really forcing. He's just like we talked about how Alvaro was trying to isolate what he identified as Shane's weakness, his forehand. Obviously, Shane has identified Alvaro's backhand as his weakness really done a great job isolating it, creating some weak returns, and taking total control of the match.
Well, Shane Vanderson dominating game four here. He's up 2-1. We're going to take a little break here as the Towel Boys wipe up the floor. We'll be right back for more of this men's pro quarterfinal at the 2006 Choice Hotels U.S. Open Racquetball Championships. The Choice Hotels U.S. Open Racquetball Championships is brought to you by Choice Hotels International, family of hotel brands with over 5,000 locations and 8 different brands worldwide, offering every type of accommodation in every price range. We meet all your travel needs. For reservations, visit us at choicehotels.com today. Choice Hotels, we'll see you there. And by Wilson Art Flooring. If it's tough enough for pro racquetball, it's tough enough for your home. Enjoy the beauty and durability of Wilson Art Flooring, available at fine floor covering centers everywhere. Also, Nuveen Investments, dedicated to helping you reach your goals in life. Ask your financial advisor today how Nuveen's growing range of equity and fixed income products can help you support your long-term plans. And by USA Racquetball, your link to the greatest game on earth. To learn more about how racquetball can improve your quality of life, visit usaracquetball.com for all the details.
It was almost 50 years ago when Danny Thomas had a dream. A dream of creating a unique research hospital devoted to curing catastrophic diseases in children. More than just a treatment facility, this would be a research center for children from all parts of the world. St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital has always played a big part in the sport of racquetball. Every year since the U.S. Open began here in Memphis, the players take time out to go over and visit these children. The Choice Hotels U.S. Open Racquetball Championships has donated now over $100,000 to St. Jude's. This helps in advancing the research and treatment for these brave children. Not only is this great for the kids to meet these professional athletes, but it's also a reminder to the players and all of us, truly, what real strength and courage is all about.
Time's it. 5-1.
Wow, that's so tough. Shane Vanderson, we can't say it enough, the hand speed.
6-1.
Be flying all over the court and then have the presence of mind to just nice and easy touch with the backhand. He's got great hands up there in the front court.
You know, Shane's in total control, and I really like the way he looks right now on the court. His head is down. He's very focused, taking his time in between points. Really looks like he's maturing as a player.
Wow. Again, Shane Vanderson with the quick hands on the backhand side.
You know, about midway into that third game, Shane just kind of found his rhythm. We talked about nobody had really found it. His lob serve really relaxed him, and he is absolutely in the zone right now, hitting that serve great and following it up unbelievable.
Nine, serving one.
You know, really, Shane's just been the better player today, particularly his last two games. He's just really dominated, controlled the rallies, played more poised, played more mature. This is really, I think, a coming-out match for Shane here in the quarterfinals of the U.S. Open, taking down a higher-seeded player, putting himself in position to play for his first U.S. Open final in his young career.
When we do these interviews for television, I like to ask if they think match per match. Do you think about getting to the finals? What are you thinking about? Right now, Shane Vanderson, when I asked him that question, he was ready for the finals. And he was talking about gunning after Jack Huzak even. So
wow.
Pretty crazy that...
That's certainly not a best practice in most sports psychology world.
And Shane Vanderson has gotten one step closer to his dream of playing Jack Huzak in the finals of this U.S. Open. Shane Vanderson takes this match, moves on to the semifinals. An exciting match, Aaron.
Yeah, great match by Shane. As we talked about towards the end, really stepped up, really separated himself from Alvaro. He's in the semifinals now. He looks very focused, very relaxed. He is a very dangerous player right now. As we talked, he's got all the physical ability, and it really looks like he's starting to pull it together mentally as well.
If you're following the U.S. Open on the Tennis Channel, we're covering eight matches as a series. So please tune back in, watch more exciting racquetball. Check out the website, irttour.com. Thank you for watching. For myself and Aaron Katz, see you next time.